What's up, guys? Today I'm going to share with you a method, a screenwriting method that I've been using for the past few weeks that has really clarified my ability to understand structure and story, and it's made writing a lot more fun, organized, and engaging for me. So I basically came along this theory by watching a film a few weeks ago. It's called Fracture. It's from 2007. It's with Ryan Gosling and Anthony Hopkins. And from the film, I derived this theory, as you can see, crazily broken down on this chart behind me, which I'll discuss a little bit. The aim of this approach is to essentially create plot organically, completely from characters, their traits, and their decisions. And what's so special about this movie is, one, it is a murder mystery. It's a court drama. That's the realm it's in. So on paper, so to speak, it seems very plot-driven. And when you're watching it, it feels plot-driven, all the twists and turns that happen. But when I actually broke it down back there, I found that every single thing that happens in the film is connected to characters' decisions. And I thought that was amazing, that it was so deceptive in that way. The second interesting thing about this is the writer of the film uses a writing device. He integrates a writing device into the plot. So he uses the writing device of exploring characters' flaws, because we're taught in writing classes that you should always understand your character's flaws. You can understand their weakness, their psychology, their want. And that actually becomes the central philosophy of the film, that everyone has a flaw.
You know, I used to candle eggs at his farm. Do you know what that is? You hold an egg up to the light of a candle and you look for imperfections. First time I did it, he told me to put all the eggs that were cracked or flawed into a bucket for the bakery. And he came back an hour later, and there were 300 eggs in the bakery bucket. He asked me what the hell I was doing. I found a flaw in every single one of them. You know, thin places in the shell and fine hairline cracks.
There's a killer in the film, and it's one of those sort of philosophical killers. And he manipulates people by finding everyone's flaw. And if you can see in that corner up there, I have a phrase written, a quote from the movie. It says, "Everyone has a crack." That's sort of the tagline of the film, and that is what the killer believes. So I'm going to explain to you the plot, and then I'm going to explain to you what I derived from it. So the plot of Fracture is a man kills his wife and confesses to it.
Shots fired.
Hostage situation.
Your wife, is she here?
I shot her.
You shot your wife?
I got the gun. I shot her in the head.
But the court convicting him does not have enough evidence to convict him.
The gun is no good.
What do you mean the gun's no good?
Never been fired.
No prints, no weapon,
no blood.
The guy's screwing with us.
And there's a hotshot young lawyer at the center of this. His name's Willie. He's played by Ryan Gosling. And he has a 97% conviction rate, but what he finds out is that the killer set all of this up. The killer, played by Anthony Hopkins, his name's Ted. He's sort of a sadist. He loves the idea of getting away with things and proving to everyone, because everyone in this case basically thinks he's sick in the head. They say there's something not right with him.
Be careful with this guy. There's something not right about him.
I go in there with a signed confession and I put this guy in jail.
But what he's proving is there's actually something not right with all of you. He begins pointing out all the flaws in these characters' personalities that prevent them from being able to catch him, even though he just gave over a confession to them.
You look closely enough, you'll find everything has a weak spot where it can break sooner or later.
You're looking for mine.
I've already found yours.
Yeah.
Is it safe to say that someone who inflicted this kind of wound intended to kill?
Yeah, I wish to object. I don't know the legal terminology, but
what would you call it when the officer who arrested you has been having sex with your wife?
And you'll have to watch the film to find out how he pulls that off. But the point is that their flaws get in the way. And that's the philosophy of him and the philosophy of the film, that everyone has a flaw. So the writer took this staple of screenwriting and injected it into the story. So what I did is, after I watched the movie, I realized this, and I started thinking about that idea that everyone has a flaw. I started really taking that to heart. And I started thinking about every single character in the story. You can't see all of them here, but I thought, what would their flaws be? And eventually, streaming into my brain very quickly, I realized that each character had a very distinct, discernible flaw. And so I started writing down, as you could see in the small font over here, all of their actions that are connected to their flaws. Everything they did that was very clearly influenced by the flaw attributed to them by the writer. And what I found was, by the time I had finished writing their actions that are connected to their flaws, I had written every single thing that happened in the movie. So I thought to myself, if you can write an entire plot based on characters' actions determined by their flaws, why not just use this method for your own script? And that's what I've been doing ever since. This is something you can do. I hope you're able to see, but I wrote their background, because that's something that's so helpful about a flaw. It not only tells you their actions, it also tells you where they came from. And then you get to understand them more and make them a more detailed, realistic, comprehensive character. So for example, Willie, his flaw is winning. This is something explicitly stated in the film by the killer Ted.
I've already found yours. What is it? You're a winner, Willie.
Your Honor, I'd like to waive my right to preliminary hearing and go direct to trial as soon as possible. Does that help you, Mr. Beecham?
You don't have to worry about Mr. Beecham, Mr. Crawford. The district attorney's office will assign another prosecutor.
No, I like Mr. Beecham.
Mr. Beecham, he likes you.
Yes. Ted selects him specifically to convict him in court, because he knows that Willie is so blinded by his winning that he's very susceptible to Ted's toying with him. So anyway, we learn that Willie is obsessed with winning because he works in a vacuous, shallow, affluent LA society, but he comes from a very poor, humble background in Oklahoma, where he worked his way through law school. He's $60,000 in debt. And so he's had a chip on his shoulder his whole life. He's always felt the need to overcompensate, to work twice as hard as everyone around him, who in the story, a lot of people have had things given to them as opposed to him. And we see that the flaw is the nucleus of the character. It's core to who they are, because it's the bridge between the past and the future. It's the bridge between the character's trauma and a character's action. Because characters aren't just flawed for no reason, just like we're not flawed for no reason. You know, we weren't inherently born bad people. Characters, like people, have had trauma in their past, or a series of traumatic events that has influenced all of their actions in their life following those events. So this is crucial to know, but two questions you may be having at this point are, all right, one, there are so many flaws, we all have so many flaws, how do you select one for a story, as I've done behind me here? And the second one is, okay, once you have your flaw, how do you determine your character's actions? Because even if you have a flaw, there are so many actions you can take based on that. How do you determine that? So I'm going to answer these two speculative questions in reverse. First, I'll say that I'm assuming if you're focusing on this point of the story, developing and designing your plot, you've already come up with your premise. And that's something that's very important, is you have to nail down your premise, because it's very hard, if not possible, to go back on that. And the reason I say that is because what a premise is it's an event or a specific moment that you have carved out and chosen from history to represent the story you want to tell. And what a premise is an event that characters react to. So character action can only happen if there is an external premise and an internal event for them to react to. And once they react to that premise, their flaws come out. A real life example is us. We all have flaws, but we don't walk around all day being stimulated and those flaws just bleeding out of us. But sometimes something really intense and shocking will happen in life that makes us vulnerable And before we know it, all our flaws are just acting in full throttle in our body. And then someone could study us and write a screenplay on us. So that is how that's the answer to the first of the two questions. You basically need to come up with a premise first before you start determining your character's actions, because actions, again, just to reiterate for the last time, actions are reactions to the premise. You can't have actions in a vacuum without there being some sort of event triggering them. Then the other speculative question is, now how do you choose out of all your flaws what to be the main flaw for your character? So I'm going to answer this question by naming two major qualities of flaw, of what your main flaw would be. First one is, a character's main flaw is often the same as their main strength. And that's why it is a flaw that they keep with them so long. Because as you notice with this story, Willie's flaw is winning. Now you can obviously also look at it as a strength. It's a strength because it has gotten them to the point of success that they're at today. And it remains a flaw in them, and it starts to become and develop into a flaw in their personality, is because they are so deceived and blinded by their own success that they have achieved with it, that they don't see the problems with it. It's almost like a deal with the devil. Oftentimes, strengths are too good to be true. And so this leads me to the second part, the second quality of a character's main flaw. It is the number one trait in a character, which if they continue to embody it, they will eventually destroy their own lives and the lives around them. Using this story as an example, what Willie realizes is his desire for winning, his flaw, his obsessiveness with winning, is not working for him anymore. He has encountered a killer who basically manipulates people based on their flaws, based on their cracks. So Willie is being manipulated, and he finds that the only way for him to convict him, to solve the crime and truly win in the end, is to overcome this flaw and approach the case from a different level. This is something that's very important in screenwriting, but he starts to feel a moral obligation because people are dying, and they're dying because of his ineptitudes in handling the case. What's ironic throughout this story is that all of the characters have flaws, but Willie is the only one who overcomes his. And that is why he's the hero of the story, and that's why he's able to solve the case. More or less, everyone else in the story is not emotionally aware enough, and they all settle with their flaws. And in the end, we view the end of their arc as sort of failures. So anyway, just to wrap this up, I'm going to show you this board and show you that each character, I came up with their flaw. And like I said, all this little print are the actions that resulted from the flaw. And if you see the movie, you'll find out that that's the entire movie. And ever since watching it, I've been using the same process, the same method with my own screenwriting. I sit down, I look at my script again, I say, what am I missing? I write down the characters, I write down the flaws, I solidify the premise in my mind, and the actions begin to flow out. And once you have the actions resulting from each character's flaw, then those actions begin to interact with each other, because these characters aren't acting alone. And from that, you begin to see a really interwoven plot that looks plot-driven, but you'll soon find it's very much character-driven.